I wanted to start off this evening by asking you a question that philosophers and mankind have looked at over the years. And as a philosopher and spiritual and thinking man yourself, I know that you have given this a lot of thought. What is the meaning of life?
Okay. My perception of what the meaning of life is, or I could say my opinion what the meaning of life is, that we are going through cycles of life which are based upon the transformational states which the universe goes through, and to be harmonizing with this so that we actually become functional in this universe. I cannot believe that we just popped up for no reason. Very much as that a particle of moisture eventually might become a snowflake and doesn't have any memory that it was a particle of moisture first. It takes its own characteristics, its own form, and it fulfills its function as long as it has to be snow. And then it might change again in hail, and it has forgotten what it was as a particle of moisture, what it was as a snowflake, and now it fulfills its function. And I think this is our temporal state in this big process of transformation, as the scientist says, that this universe exists out of energy, which produces itself as light and sound, which cannot be created, cannot be destroyed, can only be transformed. Well, what are we then? Like the snowflake was a part of the transformation of that moisture, we are also part of that energy that constantly is in a state of transformation. So this is a transformational situation we're in. So even though we lately are seeing all the literature coming out of transformation, well, that is the universal process, so we better get with it and start understanding what each individual has to do with that, and therefore search within himself, what are the potentials by which I can express this? What are the tools I brought with me? And we didn't bring all the same tools with it. Like we haven't been able to find one single snowflake to look or be the same as the other snowflake. I think with human beings, it's the same thing. 750 cells in our body, approximately, give or take a couple of trillion, you know, which are similar but not the same, so they are all unique. So I as a composition, I as my body's composition, which is not me, is not my total self, you know. And one of the basic things we say in our teaching, all of the body is in the mind, but not all of the mind is in the body. So where my body cannot go, my mind can still be in touch with. And that body is created then as a very unique, as a unique being, so that therefore it has no sense to keep comparing to others. We can use others as models, but we can only bring it out as we are and not as the other people were. So that will save us from imitation. And that the cycles of life then actually bring us back to that what we have somewhere in our higher consciousness already, the total universal information there, the knowingness. And that we bring slowly that back till we have really grown into that state that we don't need to be in this, in this vehicle, what I call the vehicle, the body, which I never need to be in to begin with, except I have to work through. See, to me, the mind is my driver to fulfill that function.
I see.
Now, most people might in their youth, when they are still spontaneous and are predominantly operating in what we say from birth till the age of seven, they are predominantly in the theta or the transpersonal brainwave. They are spontaneous, they are creative, because they don't have the belief systems yet, what tells them what other people think and know about it. So they experience it from the first hand. And so then when we get older, we go from 7 to about 13, we are predominantly trying to form this body to become a good vehicle for us to operate through. But we are also at the same time envisioning and being involved in this belief system, the data being pushed in and pushed in. And so we don't listen to that inner voice any longer. And so then we go at the age of 13, now we have to see what we can become, you know, and how we can become monetary suitable, and that we pick up the right partner and so on. Mm-hmm. And so everything is based upon the material world, very little upon the spiritual world, so we are predominantly in beta questioning thinking process. As a result that we, through all the static we get in the brain, we don't hear that inner voice anymore, no matter how loud it is, you see. And what we notice, for instance, when we have a substance abuse program in our center, and we have just finished the second one, we are about to go into the third one. The first group was adults, the second group were adolescents. And we noticed that we had to use totally different techniques. We practically had to reverse the techniques, because these youngsters, most of them have started at the age of 8 with taking the substances, because they were suddenly not comfortable anymore with all that or regulations and the belief systems which were thrown at them. And so they were still used to go into that spontaneous state, the daydreaming state, the fantasy state, the imagination state. And now they are being forced to pay attention. Uh-huh. And attention to data, not to experience anything, while their first only 8 years or 7 years they have lived in an experiential way, because they didn't have logic and reason. Mm-hmm. Things what they did spontaneously. Now they have to go back. And if they cannot do that because the pressure of the outside society is so hard on, they start looking for substances that can bring them back into space. I kind of have compared it with an astronaut which finally we get blast off, and he leaves ground station and he goes into space and he breaks the wires by which he's in contact with ground station. So ground station doesn't know what he's experiencing over there, which is the body and the conscious mind. And the soul part, the higher part, is there in space adventuring all kind of things, but doesn't get any direction anymore from ground station, nor does ground station know what is being done. So they are at a loss.
Yes.
They are, you can really say, space cadets. And every time when they come back to the world and when they're about to come down to the earth again, they feel that they are uncomfortable there and that they have to take responsibility for it. So they dive off. So where we normally, with the adults, had to start trying to get them from beta, the thinking process, into alpha, the subconscious mind, and then go into the transpersonal mind, the theta and delta, you know, with the adults, with the adolescents, we have to start first getting them into theta to catch them in space, uh-huh, where they are, and now we have to bring them back to alpha so that their body gets regulated, their body can restore itself, and then we bring them back to beta so that now they can articulate what they experienced there in space. And, you know, it took us 10 weeks of intensive training of these adolescents. And when we started with them, they had a, we gave them the Cooper-Smith test for self-esteem and self-worthiness, and they were in around the 30. And when we were through with the 10 weeks, we gave them the test again, and suddenly they had a self-esteem of 70% and higher. Uh-huh. And they haven't had relapses yet, you see. And this is a program for 3 years. We keep, after 10 weeks intensive, 10 to 13 weeks intensive training, depending how much they catch up with it and do their homework too, we then check them out for 3 years. We keep in touch with them for 3 years, and they come so many hours per week or per 2 weeks to us, and eventually might become once a month, and eventually might become once in the 3 months. But we keep track so that the moment they get the tendency to go to a relapse, we get them back again in all the different, and we don't teach them anything different than the so-called voluntary control of the internal state, so that they can act in this life with responsibility and with joy, uh-huh, yeah, and start to love themselves a little bit better and start to love their environment. It is fascinating how they discover. We also, when we have our personal session with us, mm-hmm, to say, why aren't you using that potential? You have that right there. Now, why don't you bring this out? Huh? And this is not a must. You have to have the desire to do that. Uh-huh. And so they discover suddenly that somebody knows a little bit what their potentials are. Mm-hmm. And they were never given credit for that, so they never dared to bring them out. And suddenly you start seeing, becoming very creative and start following certain directions which they before would never have thought because they were not worthy of being important at all. You know, so they are following the meaning of life much more than before, because before they had nothing to look forward to. Why the heck am I here to begin with? That's why we see so many suicidal things in adolescence. Mm-hmm. Well, now they get a purpose of life, they get a meaning of life. Also, they start feeling they have something to show society. That you can get over things which were not first not so okay. Mm-hmm. It is not just saying no.
Yes, yes, I see that.
It is this like becoming aware of that you don't even have the need for it anymore. Mm-hmm. You don't need to escape into space. Mm-hmm.
In a sense, it's like a mistaken identity that they were
exactly,
under.
Exactly. They went incognito. Uh-huh. They left their vehicle there, and their mind went out in space.
And in a my sense of what you're saying also is that the thing that so often is so judged is using any substance, being addicted, is mm-hmm. looked down upon, and yet in this, my sense of what you're saying is it's almost like a spiritual quest, that in the sense of they're seeking
absolutely
on a spiritual level.
Of course, we can use it as an excuse, you see,
and absolutely
that, and that has happened in the 60s.
Yes,
you see, we wanted to open the door to our inner being, mm-hmm. and we couldn't do it in a normal circumstance because society just didn't allow us that. Mm-hmm. Okay, at least we thought it didn't allow us. We never tried it really, because we already knew that we were going to be punished for it, you see. Mm-hmm. And this is with the kids too. So what did we do? So we started using drugs, right? And that was to open our door to consciousness, to higher consciousness, which we then called ASD, right? Alternate consciousness, uh-huh. you know. And when we did that, we got so enthralled by that experience that we didn't want to take the responsibility for it. And every time when we got out of it, we threw the door shut again. Mm-hmm. And we had to use the key again. Uh-huh. Rather than to use that experience as the basis, the basic foundation for a new change again. See, I cannot imagine what more joy you can get out of a great joy when you have had a joyful experience, and then to have it do it over and over again, if it will be as joyful or more joyful, I cannot see that. Uh-huh. I think that only by having a new experience then, mm-hmm. is you don't have to get through the substance anymore. Mm-hmm. You will be much more better to bring out what you have gained and bring it out into your society and start living it, mm-hmm. you see. And I think that's what we have to be careful with, that even though it was maybe for a spiritual quest, mm-hmm. The fact that we became addicted to it, it is as easy to become addicted to the spirit as that it is becoming addicted to this society, uh-huh. or anything that happens in this society, you see. This is why we bring out the word non-attachment, which most people still think to be detachment.